This stuff, for me, when I started medicine 30 years ago, was, well, this is science fiction.
Hey, it's Mike Hill and you're watching Futurist World, your home for big ideas about the future and how to adapt to our rapidly changing world. Get ready to launch your thinking right out of the box, because today we're sitting down with health activist and visionary Dr. Rob Grenfell on the future of health. We connected with Rob at his office in Melbourne, Australia. Rob Grenfell is the Director of Health and Biosecurity at CSIRO, Australia's leading scientific research agency. He graduated from Monash University and began his career as a country doctor. After specialising in public health, Rob's work has subsequently led to executive roles at the National Heart Foundation and as National Medical Director at Bupa Australia and New Zealand. He now travels the world tirelessly in his role at CSIRO. Rob combines the gift of imagination with a deep understanding of science and technology to drive programs that tackle major national and international health and biosecurity challenges. In doing so, he's helping us to protect the health of the farming sector, environment, people, and our way of life. His commitment to Indigenous health and reconciliation is second to none. So get ready to discover how innovation in science is transforming the future of health. And remember, if you prefer an extended podcast, please subscribe to Futurist World to make sure you don't miss an episode. So tell me, Rob, where's health going? Are we going to live forever?
Look, these are some of the toughest questions to actually answer about where and what are we actually to do. Health's actually not as difficult as many other areas to future pick. Now, there's reasons for this. Health's a very highly regulated and very highly controlled industry. And so a lot of the things that we are experimenting with now are in fact actually going to take 15 years before they come into standard practice. Now, there's a reason for a lot of those gates. You don't want to have something tested on you that's going to cause harm, do you? So it needs to be safe.
So what's the future looking like? If you know now what's going to happen in 15 years, how dramatically different is it going to be? Like, you know, I've got one of these things on my wrist, which is, you know, a device that helps me monitor my health to a very limited extent. Are we going to see more of that type of thing coming onto the market?
Sure. Data is probably one of the revolutions, as it is revolutionising or disrupting so many other sectors. The advanced monitoring that's coming through is phenomenal. Some of this stuff, looking at microsensors on your skin, measuring, in fact, actually, say, stress levels, for instance, but also some of the attributes in your sweat as to what's going on there. What's elusive at the moment is real-time monitoring of blood sugars and also real-time monitoring of blood pressure. They will be cracked in the not-too-distant future, and they will revolutionise the way we manage diabetes or heart disease.
Where do you see that going, the wearable tech? Like, how far is it going to go? How much tech will we be wearing? And, you know, is there enough processing power out there at the moment to deal with this stuff? Or do you need that next step in quantum computing, etc., to really harness the power of all that data that's going to be coming out?
Yeah, quantum computing will actually revolutionise the way we deal with large, large data sets. So to give you an idea of the complexity that's happening now, so for instance, when you have a brain scan, you go, oh, okay, that scan's got this abnormality or not. That's the only data field that I am seeing as a skilled technician. Yet a machine can take the whole lump of data that's behind there and then merge that with the other data set from the other scan. So we're merging functional MRIs with PET scans and giving greater insights as to what somebody's brain function may be doing, or giving a score on how likely they are to get dementia, or grading them with regards to brain behaviour, or even building neural pathways. I mean, this stuff, for me, when I started medicine 30 years ago, was, well, this is science fiction. But I can now see brain neural pathways in a little child with cerebral palsy, or in somebody who's just suffered a stroke, or someone who has mental illness. That is what data's doing for us now. Add in all of these other points of data, such as the wearables, but also some of the behavioural metrics. It's going to give us incredible insights into how's your health going now, have you actually got any diseases, and how is the management working on those diseases. very exciting times to be involved in healthcare.
You know, one thing we all share as Australians and also with our neighbours like the, you know, and our friends in the US and Canada and elsewhere is that, you know, 60% of us are one sandwich away from fat. We've got a massive obesity issue, right? And it's growing. How are we going to deal with that going into the future?
Look, the figures are absolutely alarming. The hardest nut to crack into the future is, how do I make you, Mike, know that you should not eat that hamburger, that you should in fact actually go for that long walk out into the community and get that exercise in, because you know you need to do it, but you're not. So I can tell you as much as I like.
You've got to save us from ourselves. Come on,
but I did this a lot as a GP. I used to sit there and say, Mike, you know, things are going well. Your blood pressure's all right, and your cholesterol level, she's just a bit on the edge there. Mm. And your stress levels, you know, you're pushing your stress levels. You know, you should be exercising, Mike.
Yeah.
And you go, yeah. You walk out of that clinic and you'll forget.
Yeah.
So let's take this to the future projection. Mm. And what I find exciting about, say, tech companies like Amazon and others moving into this space, or your Apples and others, is what do Apple and Amazon do that we can't do in healthcare? They can make consumers stick. So the whole concept of being nutritionally matched to your body, balanced and delivered meal program to you is in fact actually one of those ways that we may...
huge market.
Yeah, we may work towards this.
So part of the problem you've touched on there is the information flow or the information drop off between the clinician and the patient or the health professional and the patient. And it feels like that happens a lot. How big a problem is that? And how important is it that we share our health data to avoid the problem of information not being retained or just disappearing on both sides?
Yeah, and there's obviously a lot of sensitivity to the idea of accessible health records. Yeah. But let's think about what's the power of the integrated record, even if we just had what we call event summaries, or these are the drugs you're on, these are the tests you've had done, and these are the results. Yeah. And this is what's been done to you on a number of procedural levels. That's the basic level. But let's think that if I'm your GP of the future, and you've got measurables and things coming in, and they're saying to me that Mike's blood pressure's been spiking a bit lately, and he could be considered hypertensive, or Mike's looking a little stressed of late. And then it comes back to you and intuitively says, Mike, you need to actually consult your clinician.
Yeah.
The clinician's already aware of this. The dashboard's there. All of the information is needed to say, we're starting here. We're not starting way back here. Saying, now, how are you feeling?
Mm.
I don't have to ask that question. Yeah. Gee, it appears that you're actually, your blood pressure's up and you're a bit stressed
at
the moment.
Let's cut to the chase.
And then I can turn back and say, well, the data actually says that you're showing spikes of blood pressure here and here and here. Mm. And that seems to be coinciding with these particular events. Yeah. Or your sleep cycle's gone way off. And this is actually indicating you've probably got depression, Mike. Mm. Now, we need to talk about this, and we need to deal with this. So that's the assisting the human touch to actually add that to it.
Yep.
We're already piloting systems like this.
Amazing.
Yeah, so we're already piloting systems that are looking at how we're managing your recovery from a heart attack. Mm. So the nurse doesn't have to ask, so how are you going?
Yep.
It's already here. Mm. What's your blood pressure? Well, it's already here. Mm. Have you been exercising? Well, it's already here. I don't have to ask any of those questions. It's going, you know what? We don't seem to be working. This isn't going well because there's a couple of things you can do.
Mm.
There's a couple of things I can do to actually optimise what's going on. Because, hey, Mike, you don't want to have another heart attack, do you?
Mm-hmm.
No?
No.
Okay.
And not that I've had one yet.
Yet. But,
now, I know you spent a lot of time in California, and you know, a lot of the advances seem to be coming out of, you know, Silicon Valley and places like this where you might not expect it. And a bit of the focus there is, how do we extend our lives? And potentially to the point where, you know, we're going to live forever. You know, this is in the minds of some people. Where do you sit with that? That seems unnatural on the one hand, but again, maybe with everything that you've said, it's within reach.
Okay, we think about when my grandfather was born in the turn of the 1900s. His life expectancy was somewhere in the late 50s. My daughter at 19 has a damn good chance of making it to 100.
Mm.
And, okay, the realist in Rob, the GP in Rob, the someone who's seen people, and my oldest patient who I had the pleasure to treat made it to 109.
Wow.
When she turned 100, she was still living in semi-independent assisted age. She was still painting. She's really rare. When I said to her, I've never held an antique in such good condition, And she said, how much longer do you think I'm going to live, doctor? Yeah. And I said, the way you're going, another 100 years. She said, I hope I don't.
Yeah.
All right, so we come back to the quality issue. Yeah, it might be great to live to 100, but if you're a miserable sod, yeah. Really?
Isn't it partly terrifying thinking about age extension in terms of decades, you know, managing and dealing with that? Isn't there a whole sustainability side of the coin that we need to be conscious of?
Yeah, we're talking now about the surge in people over 80. There's a huge surge in population that's increasing there. The surge in over 90, the surge in over 100. So if we look at children born today and the number that again meets 110, what the hell do we do with them? The pessimist viewpoint is that we will destroy the planet and we will have to go to other planets to look for resources and a way of surviving what occurs here. So some of those science fiction doomsday prophecies of not getting our stuff together and over-polluting the area and over-stripping it may be close to a reality. On the other side is that us working at what's the balance that we've got. Science can actually obviously look at how we can recycle what we've got. So waste dumps may become the future energy powerhouses, and we may be able to get energy out of those, we may be able to get other resources out of those, we may be actually finding ourselves refining and recycling our rubbish dumps.
Wow, so mining rubbish dumps like we do fossil fuels now because they're an actual resource.
Yeah, particularly of some of the trace elements and other things that we need. But you think about actually drawing energy from all sorts of places, like ideas of actually stripping energy from the sun on our roadways. You know, there's heat.
Yeah.
I mean, why aren't we actually using our roads as say...
beaches maybe.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because there's all these types of ways of actually picking up passive energy that, that the Earth's got. Should we be looking at population control? That again is an ethical issue. But it's got a whole loads of what right have we in the developed world got to say on the developing world, stop breeding. But nature's there lurking behind in ways that we still don't understand.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, we could go on about that for quite some time, but you brought up science fiction, which is, you know, one of my pet loves. Does science fiction play a role in here? Does it provide any inspiration for what happens here?
You know, Ex Machina is one of the most frightening science fiction films I've seen about AI and AI becoming a toxic thing. We had these precursors from the Terminator series about the idea of actually coming back to fix the past where we actually allowed machines to think for themselves. Yeah. Now, when we looked at Blade Runner, for instance, the idea that once the machine got to a certain degree of smartness, it was switched off. Ex Machina took it that second level was, once we allow the machine algorithms to work to that level, now we've still got a long way to go with the science, to be frankly honest with you, but once we've got to that point and the machine's making autonomous decisions and then it develops a consciousness, we're obsolescent. We don't need to be here. So they'll look and say, well, what do we need a human for? And that runs you into Terminator. Oh yeah, when we're playing around with the idea of AI, it's the idea about who's in control here. It's a warning for us to say that beware of AI. Is this in fact actually a virus or a pathogen that we're creating that will in fact actually infect the world and marginalise us as humans? Yeah.
Popular theme in sci-fi, that one. And it's good to hear that these things come up here at CSIRO. So, Rob, thanks for the discussion. But to summarise, what is the future of health? What do you think the most dramatic vision you could paint, you know, of the future of health is in terms of the impact it's going to make on our everyday lives?
Something that actually, one, determines where your health status is now and can feed that back to you in an understandable manner and reinforce that for you to in fact actually adopt what is necessary to promote your health and maintain your health is the challenge that we need to solve to actually have that.
That's like real-time diagnostics to prevent bad health. So it's less about treatment, that idea, isn't it? And it's more about prevention.
Much more about prevention and consumer ownership and empowerment in your own health about doing that, throwing it back to you that you actually are able to deal with this and supported to deal with this. I would say an electronic avatar in some manner will be in fact that component that actually knows who you are and what's going on.
What about when things do go wrong and you need a transplant and, you know, growing body parts and this type of thing, you know? Like, is that on the cards? Do you guys look at things like that?
We've been working in this area and love the word organoids. Okay, so what are we doing with organoids now?
What are organoids?
Organoids are the cultures of your body cells, and then utilising those in a manner that we can actually determine, one, the nature of the disease, mm-hmm. but also what we might be able to do to treat it. So in the cancer therapeutics, we can now grow your cells and test them on the various number of cancer drugs that are around, and if it doesn't work on them, we don't give them to you. Mm. Okay, the challenge of growing the cells is the first hard part. But people are now growing three-dimensional guts. So we can now actually understand where your gut is and what's going on with that, and we can start to look at how it functions and how it works. It's only going to be a matter of time before we can start to actually get to the stage of maybe doing kidneys or kidney replacements for transplants. And I think in the sense of some of the polymers and implants that we're looking at, we're now looking at biological implants rather than synthetic implants. Yeah. So the idea of stem cells, I've got arthritis in my knee, I put on my own cartilage precursor stem cells into that place, they re-establish and grow.
Wow, amazing. This is blowing my mind. What about the, you know, the black dog, the depression? And, you know, I saw in your report that, you know, it seemed like there was quite a bit happening in that space in terms of diagnostics and helping people deal with mental health issues. Is that true? Do you think there's some progress at that level as well in terms of the science and tech that might come into that area?
There's an enormous amount of work that's being done across the spectrum with regards to psychological well-being, the idea of actually early interventions and detection, access to effective and efficient care. So chatbots are being trialled in the idea of managing anxiety and depressive disorders. So I use the analogy, I usually say, you know, let's imagine 5-10 years in the future, and I always sort of say the smartphone, but the smartphone won't exist in 5 years time, it'll be something else. You might push a button on the side of your head and the little earpiece works, I don't know.
2.0.
But let's imagine it's a smartphone. Hey, and there's an avatar there saying, hey Rob, you didn't sleep very well last night, and that's the fifth night in a row that it's been like this. And I've also noticed that through the day, you've actually been a little bit short-fused on a few things. You've been getting upset by a number of things. Now, you know how we talked about this last time, that we were talking about the idea of a bit of mindfulness meditation? Well, we're actually going to do this now, because this is going to help us get through the day. And I look at it and I'm going, right. And I see the window, and I, and Rob, before you throw me out the window, which will be the fifth one this week, I want you to sit back and I want you to focus and I want you to start breathing slowly. I want you to start, close your eyes and think about relaxing. It's only a matter of time before someone gets that to the finesse point, then validates it clinically that it actually is effective, which is happening, trials around doing this. We're starting to take mental health management straight to you.
And that's a wrap on the future of health with Dr. Rob Grenfell. But before you go, I've got a favour to ask. The purpose of this series is to move humanity forward and help us think bigger and better so that we can prosper in the future. So we'd love to know what made the biggest impression on you from today's conversation. Was it the wearable tech, your health records in the cloud, or AI driving healthier habits? The best conversations happen right now, so please get involved and leave a comment below. Another great place to join the conversation and find more amazing content is at Futurists.world. And when you're there, be sure to sign up for access to exclusive content and awesome giveaways, including a 12-month subscription to CSIRO's Double Helix magazine. You can find us on all the usual social media platforms via the links below, and thanks again for joining us. The future is out there. See you next time on Futurist World.
The first mobile phone I saw, the doc was walking around with this big battery pack, and I said, my response was, have you got constipation? What do you need a mobile phone for? I love it when you get it wrong.